bar in the back?
Scars and never your promise means nothing at all when walls are stone fall. It's time to walk away. To you it's okay when like you're all alone. Your promise means nothing at all when walls won't fall. Time to walk away. To you it's okay to stay and be all in all. Your words wash away. Promise means nothing at all when walls won't fall. Time to walk away. To you it's okay to say thank you.
Everybody's taking selfies. We
should be making memories, memories. I threw a touchscreen, the runaway love scene leaves you with nothing. But I keep reaching, reaching. Something's got to fill the tank that makes me tick.
Appreciative. It was amazing. She had just moved to New York. I'm like, I got it. I'm going to take her to the Empire State Building. So cheesy. I was like, I'm going to take her to the Empire State Building. I'm going to show her her whole city and show her all the possibilities of the city. She didn't give a shit. Took her to the best hamburger joint in New York.
She was vegetarian.
No, she was not a vegetarian. She still didn't give a shit. So I wrote the song about it. It's called Empire State Building. I took you to the top of the Empire State Building to show you the world from a different perspective. Much to you as it did to me. No, it didn't mean as much to you as it did to me. Well, I tripped over you at a bar in New Orleans. Yeah, you were bigger than nothing's been the same since. It didn't mean to you what it meant to me. No, it didn't mean to you what it meant to me. Love can be so clear to me. interpretation. Okay, how about This Is My Heart?
Yeah.
What about that?
This is a new song of mine that was on my, came out on my new EP back in November. I wrote with my buddy Kit Carlson. And a lot's happened in the last year in my life. I had a clean slate and no plan, really. Musically, I have somewhat of a plan, but the life stuff has no plan. I think that's great. Kind of want to go home and move, relocate, and nothing's stopping. So it's a good feeling. It's a song called This Is My Heart.
Maybe you move to Hollywood.
Maybe.
Elmore. Elmore.
Starts to get old, just like always staying downtown. The night comes undone. I always had to skip around, looking for everyone. I'm giving up on letting down, taking all the blame somewhere.
Probably 10 years ago in the States, named East Mountain South. It was all one word, East Mountain South. But anyway, he's a beautiful composer, a really great singer-songwriter, and just a dear friend of mine. He's a rad dude. And I love writing songs with him. He just has such a deep, such a depth to his person and to his songwriting. And he's just a real sensitive and sweet person. So we wrote this sensitive and sweet song together. It's called I May Not Let Go.
I may not let go if I hold you.
deviating a little bit from it, so I just was going to let PJ see what the deal is. What do you think? Wait. Huh? Yeah.
How are you
not
feeling?
No, you just have to tune. It's up to you. You can tell a story while you tune. Tune
story. That's
true. Tune story. You know what I was just thinking about? Does it... So, I just, I don't know why I just thought of this, because I winked during the thing, and I thought, you know, it reminded me of the story. This is a good story to tell while I was tuning. But it reminded me of this time, because when I, like, for me, like, winking is not really a flirtatious thing. I don't know what it is for you, but, like, it's like, hey, how you doing? Good to see you, you know? Like, oh, I'm so glad to see you, or I just recognize you. Like, I didn't realize I recognized you, and there you are, you know? So it's just a nice gesture. I don't know, I'm from the South. I just, you know, like, just I just wink at people. It doesn't mean anything, you know? It's not like, hey. But I was at the grocery store this one time. I was in the grocery store, this was when I was living in Nashville, and like, I don't know, I've never told you this story. I was in the grocery store, and there was this lady, and I don't know why, she seemed kind of sad, and I just winked at her, because she seemed like she was sad. She was this older African-American lady, and I just, it wasn't sexual, it was just like, hey, how's it going? I mean, you know what I mean, like, she was like my mom's age. It was just like, what's up? I don't know why, I just don't know why, but anyway, the point is, she ended up being behind me in line, and she had a gigantic black husband who, this is going to mean something to you in about 5 minutes. So they're standing there, and I just took note, like, and I probably winked again. I was like, oh, there's the lady that I was winking at, you know? And I was with the old bitch that I was telling you about that didn't care that I took her on the date. So we get outside, and this guy comes up to the car, this giant black dude, like, comes up to the car, and he goes, which one of y'all was winking at my wife? And I was like, we were so confused, because I'm like, what's he talking about? I don't even remember, like, I literally didn't even remember that it happened. He stuck his head in the car and was like, I want to know which one of y'all was winking at my wife. And she and I looked at each other, she's like, put the car in reverse, yo. I had a sunroof at the time, and he's over the top, and this guy was humongous. I'm like, dude, I don't know what you're talking about. He's like, man, obviously y'all got a good thing going on here. I don't know why you gotta, like, run around trying to take other people's wives. And I was like, holy shit. Like, I just, so anyway, we left. And that just, so right when I knew, obviously, you weren't gonna try to beat me up. Like, or you weren't gonna try to beat me up. Yeah. But I, yeah, but I just thought about that, and I was like, wow, maybe I should stop doing that. So I looked at myself, maybe I should stop being nice to people in the grocery store. I never told that story.
No.
I want to know which one of y'all was winking at my wife.
Where to wink at?
Where to spring at?
That's
awesome.
What can I say? This is a tune off my record Surface that I wrote about karma and how it circles back and all that stuff, good and bad, and how you never know unless you try or at least put something out there to the universe to let it happen. And one of the best examples of you never know got me right here, pretty much. Right now, because when I was releasing my 2009 album, Always and Everywhere, I put together a bunch of promo cards with the release date on it and some tour dates. And I ordered 2,000, but the printer misunderstood me and heard 10,000. So he made 10,000, he calls me, he's like, dude, I made 10,000, come pick them up. I'm like, whoa, I just want 2,000. Shit, well, no offense, but I don't want them, so come and get them. On me, my mistake. So I kind of went into, like, what the hell am I going to do with all these things? And long story short, the record label said, hire a kid to go fly our show. And I did just that, gave him a stack. And he went to Central Park to the Josh Ritter show, where there happened to be a woman from the Netherlands visiting, staying on Central Park with friends who had tickets to the show, and they couldn't go last minute, so they gave them to her. Her name is Miriam, and just happens to be in the back of the room. I won't point her out. So she kept the card, And my guy's flyering, she got the card and liked the artwork. We got home to the Netherlands and checked out my website. I think she just wanted to find the artist, a literal artist. And my music came on and she dug it. And then one thing led to another. We had a conversation that lasted a few years before I actually got here. So since then, doors have opened. People have come into my life that have opened more doors. And that's just a story of you never know. And someone else's mistake, the printer. If the printer didn't say, oh shit, you know, that might have never happened and I might not be here, so. It's kind of what's behind me, so, in a way. Tugging at the ribbon just to watch it regrow, where it'll touch down, I don't know. So close for so long, you sadly be missed, tied around my wrist now in the middle of my fist. On three, something that nobody knows. How long will it take to get to where it goes? And let the time show and the wind blow. Let go. Watch it soar as it climbs through the night. Don't worry if at first don't feel right. Best part of my day is saying goodnight. Please don't be bitter. I attached an S-A-S-E, so please mail me the litter. So what I put out there is coming right back to me. Eventually, and here goes something that nobody knows. How long will it take to get to where?
I'll be my savior. I grew up I grew up in the church. I grew up in the Methodist church. And I went to private Christian school my whole life. And for me, it was like I wish I hadn't been so immersed in the type of Christianity that I was immersed in. It did not have a good effect on me, let's just say. it's weird because I still, to this day, it's such a bummer because I'm so grateful that I started in the church or that I grew up in church because I love the idea of faith. I love the idea of something bigger than me that I can lean on because I don't feel like me being the head of the ship all the time is the greatest answer. I don't feel like that's very comforting for myself, but the idea to have something to fall back on when I don't have my own strength to draw from is a beautiful thing to me. But the organized religion thing just didn't work for me. And the type of Christianity that I grew up in was very suffocating. And, you know, one thing, just to be frank, which I'm sure you've realized by now that's how I am. To be frank, you know, the whole idea of Jesus and just the idea that if it's either like Jesus or it's nothing and you have to do it this way or you suck and if you don't do it this way, you're going to burn in hell forever. I just was like, well, man, that's just not enticing. You know what I mean? Like, the way, are you okay? The same thing happened to me. The idea of having that shoved down my throat is the only way. And it's not even about Jesus, it's just about anything. You know, I don't want to be forced to eat broccoli, man. I won't eat the broccoli because am I eating the broccoli because I like broccoli, or am I eating the broccoli because somebody told me I had to? Chances are I ain't eating the broccoli if somebody told me I had to. So I got to thinking about that and how much I've struggled at getting older of just, you know, it's been real confusing to try to find the place where I belong in terms of my faith. And I'm kind of resentful about that, to be honest, because I feel like that was sort of a burden that I didn't ask for, you know? But I guess that's what life is. You get the burden you don't ask for and you work your way out of it, you work your way through it. So I wrote this song called Be My Savior, and it's basically like, look, man, you know, Jesus, if you want to hang out with me, then hang out with me. You know what I mean? Like, and I'm not chasing you down. I'm sorry, I'm not chasing anybody down. So. God knows I've tried that too.
So if you want to be my savior, be my savior.
Hey, how about bend it?
Sure.
And then we can take a little break.
Perfect.
What say ye?
I say y'all.
Okay. Actually, y'all.
Let's lay the break.
Garrison and I wrote this song in Des Moines, Iowa on a day off last March. No, last June. We were doing a day trotter session and had a day off, and we wrote this half inside, half outside on the porch. And it's called Pentatilla Breaks. It's our first single over here, and it got played on Radio 1, and we're going to be on Radio 1 tomorrow night. I don't know how to say it in Dutch. Met Morgan. Something. Eye on tomorrow.
Met Morgan.
Correct.
Met, I just swallowed my tongue.
Yeah. Tomorrow night on Radio 1. Wait, what is it? I got a bug. Slowly. What is it? Met.
Het oog op morgen.
Met het oog op morgen. Cool. That's where we'll be tomorrow night.
What time?
11.
11.
Live. Radio1.nl, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sure.
brace yourself for a pitfall. There's a ground war coming. Ground war coming. This isn't for the faint of heart. So pace yourself for a false start. There's a ground war coming. It's a slow crawl.
Something right here.
Bittersweet. PJ has the guy that runs PJ's record label, which now I'm a part of also, his name's Jonathan. And he has this ridiculous house in the Palisades in Los Angeles, just overlooking the ocean. No problem. So PJ hangs out there sometimes when he comes to town, and so we sat there and among other things we did, we wrote a song.
It's the most beautiful setting on the planet.
It's pretty crazy.
It's on a cliff, and the Pacific is right there, and it's just...
It's just ridiculous.
Wow. I've been there.
You have?
Yeah.
You've been to the Palisades?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
It's a great place to write. Mm. And we came up with this song.
Yeah.
It's called Bittersweet.
Because I care, so.
I went down to the corner for $10 smokes. I met an old woman who saw life as a joke. She asked for a vodka and a bottle of rum. I had just begun. Tomorrow's the first of 100 at sea. You never can tell what the water will bring. Yeah, but that doesn't matter to a sailor like me. I was born to weather the storm. She's just like a lover. She rocks me to sleep. She calms and she moves me. Her love is so deep. Oh, can the waves crash down? She's just like a lover. Oh, she's just like a lover. Oh, well, the boy said today was a hell of a day to go sailing away to the edge of the bay. Yeah, those boys always seem to have something to say. Yeah, those boys are always talking. So we sat out at dusk under bright yellow stars. Oh, I swear I could see all the way out to Mars. Sometimes she still wore me up in her arms, as if her arms could hold me. She's just like a lover. She rocks me to sleep. She calms and she moves me. Her love is so deep. Oh, can her waves crash down? She's just like a lover. Oh, she's just like a lover. Oh, she comes in with the wind and goes out with the tide. She leaves me low after getting me high. It'll never be fair and I'll never know why. Oh, but she is always constant. Now the wind's dying down and it's time to head in. I can already feel the longing begin. Cause we knew where we started is where we gives love when she wants it. She's just like a lover. She rocks me to sleep. She calms and she moves me. Her love is so deep. Oh, but can her waves crash down? She's just like a lover. Alone at the bar with my last cigarette, trying hard to remember and not to forget. But sometimes I guess you just get what you get.
Is this the time to talk about it right in front of everybody?
I'm not afraid because we're all friends here.
That's right.
I'm gonna go deep though.
Go deep?
You asked for it.
Yeah.
Well, it's to me, it's about, I don't know how the listener interprets it, but to me it's about a couple that didn't make it, but appreciated getting to a spot where they got to, and I've always I've always strived and always thought that I was going to have a child at some point. And I think, in my eyes, having a child is very, very strong and champion-like thing, in my eyes. I don't know if I'm going to have one. I might not. I might. Who knows? But it turns out that I wrote this about a couple that didn't make it as a couple. And oddly enough, it's turned out to be a little autobiographical.
Prophetic?
Correct.
But you know, can I just offer you a little encouragement?
Sure.
About having children?
Yeah.
I know nothing about having children except for this. If you're a dude, the odds are definitely more in your favor got a window and it starts to approach the window and then it's too late. But with a dude, man, be all in your 70s and
yeah.
Get it. Get you some.
Yeah, but I wanna be able to bend it over and pick them up. So we have a window too.
Yeah, but you got your windows much bigger. Bigger window. I'm just saying, don't give up.
No, I'm not. I'm prepared for anything.
You can spread your seeds still.
Anyway, this is called Champions and Guardians. And I love singing it with Garrison. Onward, around, and back again. Just hung up with a best friend. Is this the way I was then? Am I new to you? The way you never knew before. Just kicked down the front door. Your every day is no more. It's brand new to you and me. It's so easy to see. All at once, it's me. All at once, this all appears among the two of us who never knew each other much. And just for fun, look at what we've become. All at once, champions and guardians. Oh. When shall we two meet again? In thunder, lightning, or insane. It'll never be the same. Thanks to you. So wake up one day and wonder why. Are gone besides the beginner of life. Welcome. All at once, this all appears among the two of us who never knew each other. Yeah,
I wrote when I was probably 18, which was not last week, if you know what I'm saying. But, yeah, you know, I don't know. I've never really, it doesn't matter. I've never really told the story about the song. But when I was 18, I wrote the song. And PJ had been covering the song for a long time. And then that's kind of how we got connected.
He was true.
Covering the song. And then Miriam, what did Miriam say, PJ?
She said, I think the two of you would be great friends. You should contact her and tell her. I think you would hit it off beautifully.
And she was dead right. I mean, spot on. I love this woman. And I don't know. It's another thing, if you don't put it out there, if you don't try, if you don't, you never know. I started covering that tune when I was in my 20s, and now I'm with her, singing it with her. It's bizarre.
Well, it was funny because, you know, I got this email from this guy, PJ Pacifico, will you sing on my song, Hold Me Austin? And I was just like, I don't know, who's this guy? You know, I don't know, this dude like contacted me out of the blue. But then Miriam had sent me a follow-up email like, listen, you gotta, we listen to PJ's music, he's an awesome dude, you know? So I listened to the song, I really liked it, and I sang background vocals on it, and we've been friends ever since. So this is kind of the song that, made it all. And listen, I'm just lovingly gonna advise you to maybe not stand on that, because I don't think you should stand on that.
Okay.
I was standing on it, and then I saw this. I stopped standing on it. Yeah. I don't want to lose you, too. I just stopped it.
See?
Oh, that much. There it goes. PJ? Yeah. Almost down there. All right, here we go.
We are holding our breath.
grabbed my manlyhood and got the courage to ask Garrison to sing on back in 2012. It's a song called Hold Me Austin that needed a female part, and I thought, since we were connected through in Holland, why not this be the first time that I reached out to her, which I did, and she said yes, thank God. And a song about Austin, Texas, and touring on my own. I had toured on my own for 5 or 6 years in a rental car, totally solo, and sometimes for a month or more at a time. And it can get a little weird sometimes, and the thing about touring on your own or with anyone is like, once you really get into the groove, it's time to go home. Like once I really adapt and feel it, it's time to stop. But for this particular tour, I was struggling a lot. I had recently stopped drinking, and Austin's a big drinking city.
I can't believe you went out on the road by yourself, newly sober, playing gigs in bars.
It was tough. It was.
I don't know how you did that. I don't know if I could do that.
I don't know how I did either. I just didn't want to do it, but I did it. And I got to Austin. It was so alcohol based. At least for me, that's all I saw. And all these tempting bars. And I don't know. I used to get dressed up to go sit in a bar all day. I'd shower and like look great and feel great and like just go sit there and get hammered. And like, so during the days walking around in Austin, I'd see these bars and like could totally picture myself in those bars. Easily tying one on for hours. But I don't know, thank God I didn't. I went back to the hotel and got in my bed, and there's a free magazine in the desk there. And the first thing I read was Welcome to Austin, Texas, where there are over 8,000 people, 8,000 musicians trying to do the same exact thing. So,
go away.
I was like, damn. I got to deal with the booze now. I come back here now. Damn. So I was just like, I'm going to write a song. It seemed like the best thing to do at the time. And thank God I did, because it led me to her. It's called Hold Me Austin. Parked on 35, bought me some more time, living on the outside of you. Looking for the first sign, lucky to twice shine. A little bit scared too, 'cause everybody here is so cool. Kind of reminds me of high school. Hold me, Austin, 'cause I've been lost and finally made it to you. You'll be fine without me. Tonight I'll just be one of 8,002. Nothing new. I stayed dry through sunny New Orleans and this progress of living clean. It's heavy when you're all alone. Looking back and remembering that all the bars that I peek in, that would have been me 5 sad years ago. Just keep walking, I've learned. Out of my fire, still I've been lost and finally
Just keep walking, I learned. Straight out of my fire, still a little burn. So hold me, Austin, 'cause I've been lost in. One of 8,002. Thanks to you.
That was not on the set list. And if you want to sing along, the chorus is just, I keep looking at myself through other people's eyes. If you hear it and you're inspired to sing, please do. I started in the music business. Well, I started writing songs when I was a kid. Poetry and songs, and I've taught myself how to play the guitar. And so I've been playing music and singing my whole life. And I started in the music business. I started touring when I was probably 15, and I started in the music business when I was 21. I got my first record deal. So music is all I've ever known. I've never questioned whether or not I was gonna play music, because I've always been playing it, you know. Didn't ever think I would finish college, and I didn't, and all that. But, you know, the short version of the story, really, the thing that matters is that what I didn't learn in the beginning of my career in the music industry is that, you know, I had to work for it. I didn't really understand what working for something meant, because it had always just happened to me. You know, like I opened my mouth and I could sing. I picked up the guitar and I could play. You know, so in my mind it was like, yeah, well, so, cool. You know what I mean? Like, I didn't really understand, I don't think I understood what a gift it was till I got older, because I could just always do it. So, you know, what's the big deal? I didn't understand why it was a big deal. Now I understand why it's a big deal. After, you know, going through three different record labels and having so many different experiences in the industry, having throat surgery, had throat surgery a year ago. So now I understand what a gift it is. I know it's a big deal now. And I know what a big deal it is to have you guys get in your car and drive over here and listen to us play our songs. I understand that now, you know. But when I first started out and I got a record deal with the biggest record label in the world at the time, I was like, yeah, great. So what? So let's go. So it's on. It's on. And then I got to a point in my career where I realized that, you know, I was just sitting around like trying to figure out, well, how come this, that, and the other thing wasn't happening? And I just kept looking to other people to become accountable for why my life didn't look the way I wanted it to look. It was somebody else's fault, always. I'm an only child. It was always somebody else's fault. And so it's a beautiful process that I've been through, and the reason I tell this long story is because I feel that it's important to share with you that I've been through this really wonderful experience where I've been humbled to the point of being really accepting and very grateful now for everything that I have. And it's funny because I grew up, did you guys grow up in the church at all? If I say the story of Job, you don't really know what I mean. Let me just tell you, because this is important. This story pretty much fucked up my entire childhood, but it's now coming around to a place that I sort of get. Like, I sort of get the parable now. But anyway, long story short is, Job was this dude who was like God's faithful, most faithful servant. This is why the Old Testament needs to be ripped out and buried in the dirt. But anyway, Job was the most faithful servant, as the story goes, right? And he just served God. That's all he cared about. So the devil came to God and was like, hey, I bet you if I like screw up Job's life, he won't worship you anymore and he won't want to follow you anymore. So God was like, bring it on. So basically God allowed Satan to test Job to the point where he would say, screw it, I don't want to follow this God because he's an asshole, right? So basically, you know, the devil did all these things. Job lost his family. He lost everything he had. They killed off his whole family. So it was just Job was the only one that left. And he was the only one who was left. And he was still like, God, I don't understand why you're doing this to me. I still worship you. I still serve you, but I don't understand. So at the end of the day, God was right. Job never gave up his faith. But he had to go through all this crap, like the worst crap ever. So at the end of the day, as a Christian, like I looked at that and I was like, why would I want to follow a God who would just do that, who would just test me like that, you know? So I guess, I don't know if I'm going to be able to connect this story because I've had a couple of beers, so I don't know if I'm going to. This happens to me. Sometimes I go down such a bunny trail that I can't remember where I started. But I guess the whole point why I brought that up was I realized that, you know, again, and like not really understanding what faith is for me at this point, but knowing that I want to discover it, is that at the end of the day, I think for me, like I have had to get to a place of having to be backed into a corner so much that I can see what it is that I need to see, right? So I finally got into a place with my music where I've come full circle from when I first started, which is, you know, this is the reason that I play music. This, what we're doing right now, the fact that you guys showed up here and we're having this conversation and I'm in Holland and we're having this conversation. We don't speak the same language. We don't say the same stuff. But we understand this. This is why I do what I do, so that we can do this. And I appreciate it so much. And, you know, that's, this song is about me finally understanding that when I get to a place where I can't love myself and I can't believe in myself, you can love me. You can believe in me. I can love you. I can believe in you. So that's what this song is about. And thanks for requesting it, Patrick. It's called Other People's Eyes. Thank you. be satisfied. Yeah. I think that'd be cool.
Sure.
What do you think?
I'm not gonna say a word.
Okay.
I'm just gonna see what happens.
Well, we thank y'all so much for coming.
Yes.
I'm gonna do one more for you, and thank you for coming, and it's very special that you were here.
On a Sunday afternoon.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Dagmar. No one did. Yeah, seriously. You weren't kidding when you said it before. This is the coolest show of the tour so far. Yes,
there's no doubt about that.
Thank you.
We will take this with us for sure. On that note. Almost heaven, West Virginia, Blue Ridge Mountain, Shenandoah River, life is older than the trees, younger than the mountains, open like a breeze, country road.
Virginia.